This is KSTS TV 48 in San Jose, your computer connection.
Good evening. I'm John Sculley, President and Chief Executive Officer of Apple Computer. And I'd like to welcome you to this special showing of our annual shareholders meeting, which was held on January 24, 1984. But first, I'd like to apologize to those Apple shareholders who were unable to attend this meeting because the facilities weren't large enough. I'd like to assure you that in the future, we will make either ticketing facilities available to you prior to the meeting, or we will have larger facilities. January 24th was a very special day for all of us at Apple because it marked the introduction of a major new product for this industry called Macintosh. I hope you'll enjoy this show in its entirety, and I look forward to talking to you later on.
Good morning. Good morning and welcome to Apple's 1984 annual shareholders meeting. I'd like to open the meeting with a part of an old poem, about a 20-year-old poem by Dylan. That's Bob Dylan. Come writers and critics who prophesize with your pens and keep your eyes wide, the chance won't come again. And don't speak too soon, for the wheel's still in spin and there's no telling who that it's naming. For the loser now will be later to win, for the times, they are a-changing.
Till it gradually breathes.
It is 1958. IBM passes up the chance to buy a young, fledgling company that has just invented a new technology called xerography. 2 years later, Xerox is born, and IBM has been kicking themselves ever since. It is 10 years later, the late 60s. Digital Equipment Corporation and others invent the mini computer. IBM dismisses the mini computer as too small to do serious computing and therefore unimportant to their business. DEC grows to become a multi-$100 million corporation before IBM finally enters the mini computer market. It is now 10 years later, the late 70s. In 1977, Apple, a young, fledgling company on the West Coast, invents the Apple II, the first personal computer as we know it today. IBM dismisses the personal computer as too small to do serious computing and therefore unimportant to their business. The early 1980s. 1981, Apple II has become the world's most popular computer, and Apple has grown to a $300 million corporation, becoming the fastest-growing company in American business history. With over 50 companies vying for a share, IBM enters the personal computer market in November of 1981 with the IBM PC. 1983, Apple and IBM emerge as the industry's strongest competitors, each selling approximately $1 billion worth of personal computers in 1983. Each will invest greater than $50 million for R&D and another $50 million for television advertising in 1984, totaling almost $250 million combined. The shakeout is in full swing. The first major firm goes bankrupt with others teetering on the brink. Total industry losses for 1983 overshadow even the combined profits of Apple and IBM for personal computers. It is now 1984. It appears IBM wants it all. Apple is perceived to be the only hope to offer IBM a run for its money. Dealers, initially welcoming IBM with open arms, now fear an IBM-dominated and controlled future. They are increasingly turning back to Apple as the only force that can ensure their future freedom. IBM wants it all and is aiming its guns on its last obstacle to industry control, Apple. Will Big Blue dominate the entire computer industry? The entire information age? Was George Orwell right?
Today we celebrate the first glorious anniversary of the information purification methods. We have created for the first time in all history a garden of pure ideology where each worker may bloom secure from the pest.
Apple Computer will introduce Macintosh. And you'll see why 1984 won't be like 1984.
There have only been two milestone products in our industry. The Apple II in 1977, and the IBM PC in 1981. Today, 1 year after Lisa, we are introducing the third industry milestone product, Macintosh. Many of us have been working on Macintosh for over 2 years now, and it has turned out insanely great. And we are introducing Macintosh at a mainstream price point of $2,495. And you can go see a Macintosh in any one of our over 1,500 dealers in America today. I want to briefly cover some of the innovations in Macintosh. The first one is we've pulled Lisa technology down to a mainstream price point with its radical ease of use, mouse, windows, icons, pull-down menus, point, click, cut, and paste. We've managed to find a way to pull that down to a $2,495 price point. And Macintosh, to accomplish this, uses a 68,000 microprocessor, the same 32-bit microprocessor used in Lisa. It's necessary for Lisa technology, and it eats 8088s for breakfast. Macintosh comes with 192K bytes of memory. 64K bytes of ROM contains the entire operating system, the whole graphics foundation, and the entire user interface, all contained in ROM. There's 128K bytes of RAM. Just as the 5 1/4-inch floppy disk drive was an innovation in the 70s, the 3 1/2-inch disk drive will be the disk of the 80s. It is far safer, and we're storing over 400K bytes of information on one side of a disk that can be put in your pocket. Macintosh comes with two built-in serial ports. They're RS-232, RS-422, and an incredible thing called Apple Bus Interconnect. Macintosh has four voice sound and speech built in. And it communicates with you on a high definition, super crisp bitmap 9-inch black and white screen, which has over twice the number of dots on its screen of any current generation personal computer. You have to see this display to believe it. It's incredible. And all of this power fits in a box that is 1/3 the size and weight of an IBM PC. And we're introducing a family of products with Macintosh. The ImageWriter printer, an external disk drive, a modem, a numeric keypad, Macintosh carrying case, and a security kit so your Macintosh won't go anywhere without you. You've just seen some pictures of Macintosh. Now I'd like to show you Macintosh in person. All of the images you are about to see on the large screen will be generated by what's in that bag. a lot of talking about Macintosh recently. But today, for the first time ever, I'd like to let Macintosh speak for itself.
Hello, I'm Macintosh. It sure is great to get out of that bag. Unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, I'd like to share with you a maxim I thought of the first time I met an IBM mainframe. Never trust a computer you can't lift. Obviously I can talk, but right now I'd like to sit back and listen. So it is with considerable pride that I introduce a man who's been like a father to me, Steve Jobs.
The team that developed Macintosh is sitting up here in the first five rows, and they must feel awfully good right now. Well, we've got a lot of stuff to get through. Macintosh is targeted at two primary markets. The first is the 25 million knowledge workers who sit behind desks, and particularly those in medium and small-sized businesses. And the second market is the college worker. We think that's the knowledge worker of tomorrow, and there are over 11 million college students in America alone. Now, the telephone was the first and only really desktop appliance, and we think Macintosh can become the second desktop appliance for these tens of millions of people. Because of the 235 people in America, only a fraction know how to use a computer. Macintosh is for the rest of us. And we need to communicate this message to those knowledge workers and college workers. And to do that, we are launching the largest advertising campaign in Apple's history, which will premiere on the Winter Olympics starting February 6th. And I'd like to show you five commercials now.
It's more sophisticated, yet less complicated. It's more powerful, yet less cumbersome. It can store vast amounts of yesterday or tell you what's in store for tomorrow. It can draw a picture or it can draw conclusions. It's a personal computer from Apple, and it's as easy to use as this. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us. Introducing Macintosh. It does all the things you'd expect a personal computer to do. It does a lot of things you wouldn't expect a personal computer to do. And it does some things no other computer has ever done before. Of course, to do all of this, you will have to learn to do this. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us. Genius of Macintosh, Apple's newest personal computer, isn't its 32-bit microprocessor, or that it captures the power of a mainframe on a board 10 by 10 inches, or even that it costs half as much as computers half as powerful. The real genius of Macintosh is that you don't have to be a genius to use it. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us. You're about to see a few people learn to use the newest, most advanced business computer in the world. use it. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us. This is a highly sophisticated office computer, and to use it, all you have to do is learn this. This is Macintosh from Apple, also a highly sophisticated office computer, and to use it, all you have to do is learn this. Now, you decide which one is more sophisticated. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us.
This is KSTS-TV 48 in San Jose, your computer connection.